From Yarm to Yibby, Herrington to Horsley Hill, Swalwell to Silverlink, the North East Footy Breakfast with Roy, Steve and Ted.
Right across the North East, the Red, the Toon and the Cat.
Oh, boys, 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 boys.
Good morning.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning, everybody. I feel inspired. Rye has inspired me this morning.
How have I done that?
Well, I heard your song jingly thing yesterday, mate. Yep. And I'm thinking, right, I've got to come up with something worthy of this very fine show. So I've set myself a task over the weekend to come up with something for...
Whoa.
It was a bagel.
Over the weekend.
Well, rewind that. Rewind that. Excuse me.
Do you know, he doesn't have to say much, does he? He doesn't have to say much. All he says is, excuse me, and we corpse. But there you go.
No.
Yeah, so I've been inspired, mate, so thank you. Thank you for the inspiration.
Oh, no, I'm glad.
Yeah.
I'm glad. I had Sony reach out to me last night. I had to turn them down. I said, I'm not available. I'm working hard on the radio show. I cannot go into the music industry just yet. So I've put those aspirations back a little bit.
So yeah. That duet with Bieber's offers it.
Yeah. And Ted's just had his morning toffee brought in. Sorry, I said toffee. I meant coffee. See what I did there? Oh, no.
Oh. It was a horrible segue, but I loved it anyway.
Oh, and there's Steve offering his services at a price. You know, it's amazing.
This is it.
Yeah. Love it.
This is it.
You met a bit of a legend last night, Steve, didn't you?
Steve!
Well, to be honest, lads, last night's game inspired me, never mind Rye, to create a masterpiece as well. And I don't need music, lads. I don't music. So Rap is alive and well. And I want to give a big shout out. I want to give a big shout out to the Whole Gate Ender, who listens to the show. He's one of Rye's Twitter followers and one of Dave's
big butterfly
followers.
Yeah.
And he laid down a challenge. Now I got in last night. And when I got into the house and sat down and recovered from last night's defeat. It took me 6 minutes to write my little ditty, but I've got one for you this morning, lads. No music required. Oy. It's Rates Rap about
Rates
last night's
rap.
Game.
Oh, my
Love
God.
It. Love it.
I'm searching for the record button now. Well, I've already got a new ringtone.
Is it a black and white version of the Anfield rap? Is that where it is?
It is, yeah. You could say that, mate. You could say that. I mean, I don't like to big up my own work, lads. I'll leave the critiques to judge it, and I'll take them and shit.
Dangerous.
I'm excited.
He's flying by the seat of the pants this morning. It really is.
I'm all for supporting you, artist Steve. Don't you worry, mate.
Thank you, mate. Thank you.
If they were vertical black and white stripes, no problem.
maybe not so much.
I love it.
But yes, you're right. An absolute, everything caught up with Newcastle last night. And we'll look a little bit deeper into it in the show today. But disappointing. And you didn't see that coming, on the hour mark, 0-0. Newcastle looking as if they were, going to at least get something out of the game, but you don't take your chances in the Premier League, lads. You lose games, and that was a huge result for Everton. Took them out of the bottom three.
Massive.
10-point reduction. What 10-point reduction? And they'll be delighted on Merseyside this morning. Newcastle go away licking their wounds, hoping that there'll be a few more off the injury table. But you've got to take the rough with the smooth. You take the highs with the lows. Newcastle United will bounce back. This isn't the end of the world, and we crack on and we go again as the. On Sunday,
I had to watch Steve. Obviously, I do like tuning in, and I thought it was quite all fair and square come half time, and then unfortunately, Kieran Trippier, which surprised me. If I was going to put money on anyone to make a mistake, it wasn't going to be Kieran Trippier. But two mistakes there, one leading to the McNeil goal, the other one, unfortunately, lost his head a little bit towards the end of the game there.
Yeah, unfortunate, mate. He's one of our best players. Somebody who, you can usually require, you can rely on him. 100% to put a performance in. And unfortunately for us, just had one of those nights. You know, we all have them sometimes at work. I mean, Rye, you usually have one a week on the show.
Two to three.
Usually a Monday.
Usually a Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday. Yeah.
Yeah. Basically, any day ending in Y.
The good thing about bringing Ted onto the show is we don't have that, but Ted then doesn't turn up. Like yesterday, for example.
I must investigate.
He's got his armory full today. I love it.
Yeah.
He's in defensive mode.
Those arrows are flying. He's got an empty quiver already.
So, lads, what I'm going to do is, because I'd like to pay a tribute to John Lennon today, because today, again, is the anniversary of his passing. And I'm hoping Radio Dad can dig up maybe an Imagine or the Christmassy song from John Lennon, The War Is Over. That would be nice to have that on. But I'm gonna give you the rap, lads. And as I say, I don't need music. So this was knocked up in 6 minutes. Okay. Rap. It rhymes with something else, lads, I think. There we go. We'll want the full story. We'll want the full song later.
We'll have the full song later. There he is.
I'm not going to rap over that, though. No, I'm not going to rap over that. Definitely.
Okay. Rap time.
Okay, here we go. We went to the pool hoping we would rule. Mischance after chance, didn't have the tools. Injury, tiredness played their part. But if you fail to take your chances, it'll hit you hard. Losing 3-0 is a hard one to take. But losing this game doesn't seal our fate. There's a long way to go, and in Eddie we trust. But if this form continues, our quadruple is lost.
Yes. You know, after you said part, I thought I was worried about the next line. I really was.
Oh, mum's spaghetti.
That's what dad dancing sounds like.
There you go, Ryan.
Hey, do you know what, Steve? That was all right, that mate.
That was good.
Hey, it was better than John Barnes.
Real good.
Hey, tell you what, it's given me a thought for next week, fellas. Every single one of us has to come up with a rap next week.
You're less Eminem and more singing here, though, Dave.
I think the proof's in the pudding.
It'll be more Waitrose than Aldi, won't it? Yeah, go on, get it out. Go on.
Hey, Steve, I didn't mean to say, mate.
8 minutes, 50 seconds for the first bar.
Go on, Ted.
Steve, I used to actually own the whole discology of John Lennon's stuff, but I sold it all on eBay. Imagine all the PayPal.
Hey!
This is where Daz would do that.
Hang on. What's he been up to then? What's he been doing?
It's when we do my Christmas joke later in the show. He's got
Have you got one of them as well?
Yes, I'll keep that for later, though. I thought you would appreciate the rap first, because, as I say, the whole gate ender had challenged me to that. So,
I'm
proud of you.
I thought
we'd get grumpy Steve this morning. I didn't think we'd be getting rapping Steve, that's for sure. I thought we'd get grumpy old Steve. Doesn't want to talk. Was just be talking gardening this morning, but no, he's up for it. I'm proud of him.
Spitting bars and dropping gags, isn't he?
Yeah, isn't he? Oh, up for it.
I've pulled out Daz's What's It. He's got all sorts on it. What's this Daz into Christmas one?
Stand by. You're live. In 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Good morning.
Oh, yeah.
We've got a lot of good music.
Playing
your favorites, old and new. So good morning from all of the crew.
Let's sing Merry Christmas.
Oh, he does like a jingle, doesn't he?
This season, may we never forget the love we have.
Do you know what, mate?
Come in and say good morning.
Yeah, do you know what, right? You know how you don't sleep, right? He doesn't sleep. I think he just makes jingles.
Just a jingle marathon.
24/7.
That's not in like a JPEG file or a sound file saying do not open till Christmas Day, is it?
Probably.
You ruined all this Christmas stuff.
Which immediately would say to me, get it open now. Yeah. It's like Ted when Ted said, don't open this file until Tuesday. I had to open it on Monday.
You can't handle the truth.
What's that? Oh, gosh.
Okay.
Right. I'm going to shut that down. I don't know what's going to come next.
Do you get Daz a Christmas present, Dave? Do you get a little office, you know, Kris Kringle?
Just in the process.
Oh, okay.
So the first one was delivered yesterday. One of the guys is based in Gateshead Steve's turf.
Yep.
And he was down in the office yesterday, so it's probably the last time I'll see him before Christmas. So yes, he got his gift. He got his Kris Kringle gift yesterday.
Well, I'll be looking in the mail then, shall I? Me and Ted and I, obviously watching the mailman drop our big ones off.
Funnily enough, I do want some addresses off you off
air. Oh, no.
Because I have got some.
Because you're going to send the tax man round.
Yeah, the guy living in Cyprus probably doesn't want anything to do with him. Know what I mean?
It's all voluntary. It's all voluntary. Just in case you're listening, it's voluntary.
Absolutely. Yep. Do you think I would get paid for this? I mean, come on. Oh, I should be paying you.
Yeah,
no, but I have got something to send you, boys. So I have something, something creative.
Has Daz got some Jaws music?
Steve, I want to get it out of the way because I don't want to make you grumpy for the rest of the show, Steve. I got to talk about it. Jordan Pickford last night was treating that game like it was a derby. I don't know if anyone else has seen Jordan Pickford's reaction after Everton beat Newcastle last night, but it was like he was back in the Sunderland sticks and he was revving up every single Newcastle player as they were walking off the pitch, pointing and shoving and pushing, beating his chest. Steve, Jordan Pickford, how much do you hate him now?
I don't hate him. I've met the kid. He's all right, actually. He's a typical Sunderland fan, and I'm a typical Newcastle.
Describe.
Well, likes the banter.
Yeah, when you got out of that position, didn't he?
When you're in a position where you're playing against Newcastle and you get a win like that last night, then you're gonna milk it, aren't you? He's had plenty of stick. He's been on the reverse of a few hidings by Newcastle as far as football's concerned, and he's one of these people who just revels in it. So he's a character. He's been given a characteristic by Newcastle fans. People say that he has smaller arms than most. There's various inflatables have been taken at the game in a tribute to Jordan Pickford and his goalkeeping skills.
That's my chat name today.
There you go. He's basically just having a laugh, isn't he? I mean, it wound the players up at the end. I mean, look, Newcastle players.
Didn't it?
We've said this on this show for the last few weeks. You know, they can't go on like this. They can't continue in the Premier League and the Champions League in particular, continuing to put the same team out, you know, every 4 days. It's going to catch up with them eventually. And it caught up with them last night. But Jordan Pickford had I wouldn't say a great game. Newcastle's forwards misfired last night. Newcastle really should have been out of sight by half time. By the end of the game, Anthony Gordon should have had a hat trick, and Alexander Isak should have had at least two. Miguel Mirón maybe one. On another day, like they did at Sheffield United, those chances go in, and Newcastle United run off with a 3 points. You know, Everton's heads go down, and Newcastle come up trumps. But that wasn't the case last night. It was El Alamo at some points with Newcastle's forwards, but they held firm. Not many saves made by either keeper, really. Dubravka had very little to do. We saw Calvert-Lewin going into position and hitting the ball over the bar like from a Ronnie Rosenthal distance. There was so much going on in last night's game, but you couldn't see either team scoring. It had 0-0 written all over it, I think, going into that hour period. But then just catastrophe from our perspective. The mix up with Trippier, he got the ball caught in his feet, tried to be too clever, didn't come off. That 99 times out of 100 that ball falls nicely for him, and he makes a fool of the Everton player and goes past him and turns defence into attack. But last night, the ball went behind him and he couldn't get back. Newcastle's centre-halves clearly didn't expect it, and you know, credit to Dwight McNeely, got himself into a cracking position and scored a wonderful goal, and it turned the tide. But having said that, Newcastle went into, you know, went into the next 5 or 6 minutes with intent. You know, they didn't sit back. They went for the jugular. They went to get the equaliser. They should have had an equaliser. But the second goal killed it off. And that really was that. There was no way back for Newcastle. And you saw the energy. You saw the energy drop out of them. I mean, the second goal again was, you know, down to Trippier. There's no doubt about it. He lost the ball again. It was almost a replay of the first one.
Yeah.
And you know, Decore just had to side foot the ball home and you know, as I say, secure the victory. Becco came on after that and he got the third. I mean, by that time it was all over. He was played onside. He was played onside by Kieran Trippier. You know, I mean, it couldn't have got any worse for Trippier last night. And then the nutmeg, Dubravka, rubbed salt in the wounds. But Anthony Gordon last night, you know, he just didn't have the composure in front of goal. That was more like the Anthony Gordon we saw when he played, you know, in those early games for Newcastle.
When he picked off that pass, I thought he was in. When he picked off that James Tarkowski, I can't pronounce that name.
Tarkowski, yeah.
Loose touch.
Tarkowski.
When he had that loose touch on the edge there, I thought, this is it. This is where he gets it in. But he hit it straight at Pickford. I was like, no, Gordon.
Yeah,
he was getting jeered though every time he touched the ball, wasn't he? They don't forget.
No. I mean, you know, but I think he handled that well last night. I don't think that put him off last night. I just think he had one of those games, which ultimately was, you know, it just didn't fall from last night.
He played the occasion in his mind, Steve, a little bit.
I don't think he did. No, I don't think he did. I think I don't think it was getting to him as much as it did last season. Last season, I think he was more affected by it. I think he expected it, of course, and I think he handled it really well. You know, we didn't see any adverse reactions for him. I just think he had one of those nights where he just couldn't score goals. And it happens, unfortunately. There are reasons behind this, is what Eddie Howe said. He says we've struggled to change our players, and you know, that's what it comes down to. You know, he said to have the attacking options, we feel we need to change the game. That's not there for us, and that's a big miss. And he's right. It is simply down to the fact that the injury list is more or less caught up with this. You know, there's some really good players, there's some outstanding players who just aren't available, and there's nothing on that bench to change it. And we knew that, and that's been the case for the last few games. So it's been a tough night. You take it on the chin, and it's just one of those situations, and it's relentless now, because we've got to go to Tottenham on Sunday. And if anything I could see out of the last few days, it's the results. It's been a mixed bag, but you know, we're still in and around those European spots. Villa winning against Man City was probably the biggest shock of the midweek fixtures. If they had to pick a winner between Spurs and West Ham, then you'd want West Ham. I would guess a draw would have been a better result in that game for us personally. The first person to console me last night was Melly, from our Manchester United fan, who just simply texted us, "Mind the gap."
Get it, buddy.
I rang him straight away. We had a bit of banter, we had a bit of crack, but he was saying the same as me. He just says, you know, you cannot play a Premier League season like this, you know, with all of these players out and expect to have consistency and win every week. It just doesn't happen. So, but yeah, it's done. Newcastle won't dwell on it. They'll be back on the training ground this morning. They'll be hoping that, you know, Eddie Howe was saying that there's players close to a return, that those players are back sooner rather than later, but he won't rush them. It's rumoured that Callum Wilson and Sven Botman are the two players who will return sooner rather than later. But I don't expect to see those guys fit and ready to play on Sunday. I can't see it. I think that Newcastle hopefully won't have picked up any new injuries last night. It didn't seem as if they had. They've got Tottenham away on Sunday, live on Sky again. They've then got Wednesday night's fixture against AC Milan, which if there's anyone going to be fit, I think you'll have them back for that game, because ultimately that's a huge fixture. If you were to go to Tottenham and lose, it wouldn't be a disgrace, But the pressure is then, and the focus is all on a home game against Milan. If you were to crash out of the Champions League on Wednesday, that then you go into Saturday's fixture at home to Fulham, and you're at a low ebb. But it's going to be interesting to see who's fit when and when he chooses to bring them back. And I've said on the show for the last couple of weeks that I still think Eddie Howe will be focused on Tuesday the 19th of December, because the Carabao Cup quarter-final against Chelsea away for me is when I'd want most of my players back for then. If there's a chance of having Botman, Wilson and Harvey Barnes back for that game, that would be great. Because I still think, look, we know our place. The fans certainly do anyway. You know, people of my generation are certainly not getting carried away. We would like to see, you know, Newcastle back at Wembley in the Carabao Cup final. If we're still in Europe, whether it's the Champions League or the Europa League, fine. I'd rather be out of Europe. I've told you guys that just for the fixture congestion side of things. But I'd love to see Newcastle have a stronger squad going into Chelsea. And then that gives us that opportunity to, you know, to get to a two-legged semi-final again. That would be fantastic. But that's where my focus would be. It's just relentless. I'm just looking further down after Chelsea. You know, then we'll play Luton away on the 23rd. That the Christmas period is a little, I would say, a little kinder to us than it has been in the past. In the sense that, you know, after that quarter final, we've got back to back games against teams, you know, who are struggling, Luton Town and Forest, which, you know, I think over Christmas, the 23rd and the 26th, if we've got our players back by then, that could get us back on track. But you know, then we've got that wonderful week that we talked about earlier in the week, which is Liverpool away on the 1st, Sunderland away on the 6th, and Man City at home on the 13th, followed by a nice little game against Villa on the Tuesday night. So it's exciting. We'll play Luton Town as well. This is interesting. It's funny how these things happen. We're talking about Christmas fixtures and how teams used to play each other back to back within days of each other. Newcastle play Luton on the 23rd of December, and then they play the home fixture on the 3rd of February. It's quite a short gap between those games. And we actually play Luton and Forest on the 23rd and the 26th of December, but then we play Luton and Forest on the 3rd and the 10th of February. Weird that. Very rarely you see that, where the teams play back-to-back fixtures against each other so close together.
I'm just waiting for somebody to turn around and say, it's taking you back to your days, Dave.
Yeah, taking you back to your days, Dave.
What did they used to play? Christmas Day and Boxing Day, back-to-back, home and away.
Yeah, that's right. We were talking about it
back
with Daz the other
days.
Morning.
We were talking about it yesterday.
I'm not too down,
lads. It's, it was coming. We knew it would come at some point. So we've just got to accept it, move on, and, you know, just hope that things pick up. But I always just think back to where we were. You know, look back to where we were a couple of years ago, lads, and, you know, up and down like a yo-yo. Mike Ashley not wanting to spend
any. I just said yo-yo, mate.
So for me personally, I'm never gonna be down about something like that. We'll crack on, lads. We'll crack on.
Well, we haven't done the team headlines yet, so we'll dig deeper into Newcastle's, you know, performance and looking ahead to the weekend. But we've got to do the team news, fellas. You know, I'm trying to keep you on track here. At least one thing about Radio Dad is, you know, I like to keep you, you know, aligned with all our planning. So I think
it's
time.
Did you miss yesterday's, Dave? Did you miss yesterday's?
Actually, I was very impressed the way you guys kept chipping in. Well, it is 8 o'clock and time for the news. It's like, wow. Why don't
you
do that with
me? Dave, make your mind up, Dave. Why don't you? You didn't listen to the show.
I did say it was on in the office in the afternoon and I make up bits. So, okay. And there's me trying to tell you I'm impressed and now you're slagging me off. Oh,
thank you.
Just can't win.
Look, you know, you're in safe hands with us three, right? Just, you know, one day you and Daz can just sleep in. We've got this now. You know what I mean?
Absolutely. We've got that. Dave, we'll wait for the headlines, mate. Come on.
That would be interesting.
Hey. Just give me the power of the buttons, mate, and then let it
can
all...
Can soon do that, mate?
No,
don't,
no, never do that.
Never do that. I'll be sleeping until 10 o'clock. I'll be like a baby, I'm telling you.
I'll take the morning breakfast show into Daz's show. I'll get a quiz that sweeps the nation, all right? Don't you worry about that.
Here we go.
Mackems and Proud. Black Cats News.
Good morning, Sunderland. Sorry, we're obviously playing the wrong one with no ready to go there this morning.
I don't know why.
We were not ready to go, Sunderland fans. We were not. The date and time has been set for our Emirates FA Cup third round tie against Newcastle United. The Black Cats host the Magpies at the Stadium of Light on Saturday, the 6th of January. Kickoff is at 12:45 p.m. in the first Weir Tyne derby since 2016. The fixture has also been selected for live broadcast by ITV and really is the pick of the third round fixtures given the fierce rivalry over the years. The club have stated on the SAFC website that ticketing information will be released in due course. And fans obviously got an early glimpse of Derby's success last night as Macam goalie Jordan Pickford single-handedly destroyed Newcastle's title ambitions in a 3-0 rout. Sunderland are reportedly interested in Benjamin Rolheiser as they prepare for clubs to make a move for Jack Clark during the January transfer window. Rolheiser currently plays for Estudiantes in Argentina and he managed to score 12 goals in all competitions last season. He previously scored twice across the entirety of his career before that campaign. The Times reports that Sunderland have made a move for Rolheiser, but he will cost £6 million. However, you would imagine that he'll have reservations while the Black Cats do not yet have a manager in place. And finally, former England international turned pundit Carlton Palmer has had his say on the potential appointment of Will Still as Sunderland manager, claiming it would be a great move for both parties. He said, another name that's been mentioned for the vacant manager's role at Sunderland is Will Still, the current manager of Reims, who are in the fifth place in the race for Champions League football in France. Would he leave Reims to manage Sunderland? 110% if he was given the opportunity. This would be an exciting appointment. He's young, likes working with young players and developing them, which fits into Sunderland's criteria. His parents are English and he was born in Belgium. For such a young man, he's already experienced different roles in the game, from analyst to scout to assistant manager and now manager. So I guess we'll now need to ask, will the Will Still story stay still, or will we test Will's will and steal still as he seemingly fits the Sunderland bill? And that's your headlines.
Magpies and Proud, Mag News.
Newcastle United suffered their fifth defeat of the season following a 3-0 loss against Everton last night at Goodison Park. Newcastle looked to be heading for a draw, but the fatigued visitors were undone by three goals in the final 11 minutes of the game after Dwight McNeil, Albert Doucouré and Beko all got on the score sheet. Callum Wilson expects Anthony Gordon to become an England international, providing he continues to impress at Newcastle. Alongside Nick Pope and Kieran Trippier, the number 9 is one of three Toon players with the Three Lions recognition to his name. 6 goals and 5 assists in 13 Premier League games has showcased a man reborn following his nightmare at Everton, helping England under-21s win the Euros over the summer, where he was named Player of the Tournament. Also stands him in good stead with the England manager Gareth Southgate. And, as Ted has already mentioned, Newcastle made the short trip to Wearyside in the third round of this season's FA Cup on Saturday, January the 6th, with a 12:45 kickoff, and it will be live on ITV. Away allocation of tickets and prices are still awaited. This is the first time we had Derby in the FA Cup since a quarter-final tie in 1956, and the first time ever that Newcastle United and the Macams have met in a competitive match when not in the same division. That's your Newcastle United headlines on Friday morning.
Smoggies and Proud, Borough News.
Good morning, Borough fans. Welcome in to your Friday headlines. We have got football to talk about. We are missing some players, but that won't slow us down. Middlesbrough will be without 10 first-team players as they invite second-place Ipswich Town to the Riverside on Saturday. Forever coy on the injury front, Michael Carrick was keen only to talk about those that are available rather than the ones that aren't. Michael was quick to say, however, it hasn't changed the Middlesbrough approach come January. Michael said, you have to be careful buying someone to replace an injury because at some point that player will return and you would have brought someone in, so it's all just a great balancing act. And on that transfer front, a fresh update from the Daily Mail has revealed that Nottingham Forest have banished their captain Joe Worrall from first team training and confirmed he will be allowed to leave the club in January, along with fellow centre-back Scott McKenna, who has also been banished completely from the first team training. Both men have been linked to Middlesbrough previously, with Worrall the most recent in time. Could be interesting front there. Michael Carrick has also sent his best wishes over to Tony Mowbray. Oh, Tony. Admitting it was sad to see the Middlesbrough legend lose his job at Sunderland this week. Carrick said, in the position I'm in, it's never nice to see a fellow manager or head coach lose their job for whatever reason. I know Tony and I've spoken to him over a period of time from being here. We've played against him a few times and he's a good man. Oh, isn't he ever? Come on, Sunderland. And Middlesbrough will be buoyed by their performance against a strong Leeds squad last week, losing to a penalty that never should have been, and hosting the second place team. There won't be much motivation needed for those who do take the pitch on Saturday. Come on, the Borough!
Hey, fellas, I'm really excited. We've got a new gizmo in the studio.
A new gizmo? Ooh,
a new gizmo. I know you've all got to do a sharp intake of breath and go, ooh.
Okay.
Because tomorrow on the red, only on the red, tomorrow on the red, we're doing our first match day live, so we're going to be in a local pub on basically within a stone's throw of the Riverside, starting at midday, 12 o'clock, head of the 3 o'clock kickoff. And we're going to be broadcasting live with all the Borough fans as they come into the pub and quaff their beers. So we've got a new gizmo to test. And do you know what I might do while we're doing the show this morning? We need to test it in advance. I may go walk about while we're chatting. Yeah, and
I thought it was
going to
be like a waterproof microphone or something that you drop into a beer or something like that.
Well, I mean, we can stick a plastic bag around it if that's what you really want, mate.
True.
Yeah,
I mean,
bit of a
microphone in the beer.
So I might just set that up shortly, and you'll hear me go walk about around the building, see if it works.
Okay.
Yeah.
Go over to the Riverside.
You're not going outside with it, are you, Dave?
At this temperature, mate, this time of the morning, I might be daft, but I'm not crazy.
Just people will see a man of mature years walking around, you know, chuntering onto himself, talking into a little box. Just, you know, carted off to St. Luke's to finish the rest of the show.
I tell you what, mate, that's you off the Christmas card list. Gone.
Hey, I'm just looking out for you.
Lads, I got to ask as well. We got to take a cheeky bet this morning, I reckon. Steve, Ted and I want to take a cheeky bet this morning on will or will not.
Will.
Dave.
Will
Dave. Will still. Will Dave get a bacon buddy or not from Daz? It's a Friday morning prediction. Hey?
He's missed the money.
Did he slag me off at all yesterday? Did he slag me off at all?
No, he didn't.
No slagging at all. Less reason for him to bring a bacon buddy into the Radio Uncle.
It's only an apology. It's an apology bacon buddy, is it?
That's his new name, Radio Uncle. I did hear what he was called on the show yesterday because it was on in the office in the afternoon. They caught snippets, even though I didn't listen to it.
So, lads, the topic for today, former Newcastle United player, Joey Barton, who is currently sitting at home twiddling his thumbs, really went to town yesterday on Twitter. He was clearly at a loose end. He was either sitting on a train looking to amuse himself, or he genuinely got some kind of buzz out of winding probably
or just go through a nasty divorce.
All of the women on Twitter yesterday. He was basically saying, and again, this is Joey Barton's opinion, not mine, before we start getting letters of complaint or messages to the WhatsApp, that he felt that women really didn't have a place commentating on the men's game. And that, as far as he was concerned, women commentating on the men's game equals lack of opportunities for former male professionals to comment on the men's game. And what started off as one tweet ended up in just, you know, a constant barrack of messages backwards and forwards between him and lots of people. He ended up on Talk TV, I think it was, with Piers Morgan to talk about it. He got what he wanted out of it. He got some airtime.
Yeah.
And he got a chance to put stuff through. And ultimately, he shared, you know, one particular video of a woman who was commentating about the Man City RP Leipzig game. And she made a mistake. We're all prone to making mistakes when we're broadcasting. But I think fair enough, have an opinion. It's your X account. You can say what you want. As long as you say it within the community guidelines, then, you know, it's up to you. You'll be judged by those people who read it, and that's that. And opinions are like certain regions of our body. We all have one. And from my perspective, I just think it was wrong for him to highlight one particular person, because that then ends up as a social media bullying you know, a bullying situation with that poor girl. She was getting, you know, she would be getting stick. And I just felt that was wrong. If you've got an opinion, yeah, by all means, put it out there. You'll be judged by those people on that social media platform, and that's that. But I just think it was a proverbial can of worms, and you know, some of the stuff on there yesterday. I mean, I wasn't aware of it until the lads, you know, pointed it out in the WhatsApp group that we don't mention that it was ongoing. And
I think we tagged you only once.
You did. Well, obviously, yeah, I've got that WhatsApp. The good thing about you adding me in that WhatsApp group is that I don't see it until I actually go into the WhatsApp group. So it was a futile attempt, lads, to wind us up.
We are like kids.
We'll just create a new group. It's fine. We'll just create a new group and keep adding you.
You could do that, but then I'll just block you, which is what I do.
Modern problems require modern solutions, Steve.
The most modern solution is the block button, and that's dead easy. I appreciate you sending us it, lads. And obviously, I've met Joey quite a few times. I got to know him quite well when he was at Newcastle. He just loves a bit of controversy. It's as simple as that. And, you know, he's used his social media platforms on more than one occasion to have a pop. And, I mean, you know, he's been through the mill himself. Some of it brought on himself, I guess, over the years. And you know, he got a fair bit of stick back yesterday. But what did you make of it, lads? I mean, it was carnage, wasn't it, at times?
Oh, it was. When I picked up on it, I think there was a tweet from a Middlesbrough fan that had that obviously I followed and brought light to it about somebody's let Joey out of the cage or something like that. And then I managed to then open up the Joey Barton Twitter feed, and in what I've read, over 41 to 42 different tweets of absolute just anarchy. I mean, the man has lost his head. It was incredible. And the big thing in there as well is it was the disgusting moment was for me. Look, everyone's entitled to their opinion, whether it's right or wrong. You know, that's what social media is for. And that's what causes, you know, so much carnage in this day and age, is that people have a voice. You know what I mean? And some people probably shouldn't have a voice. Joey Barton's recently out of work. Obviously, he got sacked at Bristol. He was the gaffer of young Joshy Coburn for a bit there as well. So I don't know what's happened, but I hope Joshy Coburn hasn't learned anything off him. But it was just a mess for me, and it was just not needed. And the thing for me was, like, I guess he's entitled to his opinion. He's an ex-player. He obviously is out of work now. He's been sacked as Bristol manager. He's probably looking for a commentating gig or some sort of pundit work. And he thinks that all the...
He's got,
you know,
no chance
that,
now.
He's got no chance now, but he thinks that all the stations and all the media outlets are obviously filling their quota, as he had to say, which I thought was just disgusting, because I think, you know, I don't think there's a quota. I think the best person fills the job, whether they're male or female. And one thing for me was that, like Steve said, was when he dragged in the poor lass that was just doing the predictions... that's when I was a bit like, nah, mate. So, because that's what kicked it off was he referenced a video of a poor lass that was just at Man City just doing her predictions. And like I do, I mean, I do the Middlesbrough predictions, and, you know, I'm not anyone. I don't know. I just love my team and I want to do predictions and talk to the fans and everything like that. And that's all that she was doing. She was just doing it from inside the stadium. And he came on and berated her and said that it's not needed and not worth it in our game. So it was a disgusting sort of change of attitude. And I think Joey's always been on the edge of that, hasn't he? He's always been the type of person to float on that line quite cautiously. And like you guys said, he's probably just got the social media wind up to get himself on TV with Piers, get himself a bit of a payday, because I'm sure he wouldn't have gone on the Piers Morgan show for free. He's gotten his Twitter analytics up for the rest of the year. He's probably below the quota for 2023. And well done, Joey. You know.
So from my point of view, right? From my point of view, I personally don't sit and watch the analysis. I'm less inclined to watch the analysis if it's a female footballer that I don't know, because I don't watch the female football. You know, I don't watch the game. I watch the World Cup and I watch the Euros when England have played, because it's your national team, and they've done well, and I've enjoyed it. But I'm not I am not somebody who goes and watches the, you know, Newcastle United's women's team. I don't follow that. I follow Newcastle United's first team. Keep an eye on what's going on with the development players coming through. But it's not for me. It's not something that I do. I've got other things that I do other than watch football. And if I started following the women's game as well, it would be a completely different thing. So when a woman comes on from a particular team let's say Manchester United, Chelsea, whatever, and starts commentating on a Newcastle fixture on a Sky game that I potentially might be watching, I don't sit and listen to it because it doesn't interest me, and I don't know, you know, for me, it's just not for me. If though Shea Given was on, who seems to be getting quite a lot of pundit work, and he's got something to say about what he's just watched in front of him, or Alan Shearer's on, I'll sit and listen to them because they're people who I know, I've watched, and whose opinion I respect. So I don't think there's anything wrong with that. The one thing I would say, and I'll flip it as far as Joey Barton's argument's concerned, purely to be devil's advocate, is that when I've watched the women's game and I've watched the Women's World Cup, there seems to be a lack of use of our presenters, if you like, who've covered the men's game for years. So, for example, if Newcastle, if England are playing, you don't see Gary Lineker hosting the show. You see his female equivalent, and you don't see a former England international from the men's team giving his opinion on what he is watching on the World Cup, for the Women's World Cup. It's two women, ex-players plus a female presenter. So for me, you know, if it was the other way around, there would probably be complaints going in, because why you got this and why aren't you doing it the other way around? But it's always going to be a bone of contention. People love to have an argument these days. People love to make something out of something that it's not. But I think Joey Barton did this for one reason and one reason only, to get that kind of look at me, a bit of publicity, a bit of, you know, here I am, you know, I'm out of a job, get me some work, which, you know, he's allowed to do. But at the same time, you know, I think he's just created another whirlwind of social media arguments. You know, there'll been some people who woke up yesterday in the morning thinking, oh, I've got loads of plans. They'll have spent 6 hours on Twitter doing the heads in over this, doing this argument and not made any money. But Ted, it's such a contentious issue. But I think you might know where I'm coming from. I mean, look, we've all got the option of, if you don't like listening to something, go and do something else. While that person's on the TV, we've all got a remote control, or we can all get up out of a chair and press the reduce volume or off button for that period of time. You know, it's pointless getting your proverbial knickers in a twist over this.
Yeah, I mean, it's I see your point totally on this, and it's all down to personal preference. And while you're kind of, you're perfectly entitled, Steve, to go like, ah, do you know what, that bit doesn't interest me, so I'm not going to watch that. I'll watch when the game comes on, I'll watch the match live and all that sort of thing. And do you know what, there's no wrong with that, mate. Absolutely nothing wrong with that whatsoever. Me, personally, if somebody, you know, was talking about Sunderland on the TV, as in the football team, I would listen anyway. It's anything to do with the club, I'd drink it in, no matter who's saying it, what's being said, all that kind of thing. But that's just a personal preference. That's again, my opinion on that matter is just as valid as yours, and vice versa, Steve. So the reason, obviously, that, you know, that they'll push obviously an all-female presenting crew, I guess, for things like the World Cup is obviously they're trying to grow the sport. So from a marketing point of view, you know, you want more girls out there that other girls can identify with and kind of go, well, you know, even if I can't make it in the women's game, then maybe there's a career in journalism for me, or sports journalism, that kind of thing. It's all about sort of growing an area that is where women have historically been a minority, and kind of growing that marketplace, I guess. And that's why, you know, you will start to see women taking up commentating roles and journalism roles within the sport, like what we're seeing, and we're seeing a growing number of people doing that. Where Joey Barton comes into this is just, I mean, for one, you never punch down. You never, ever, ever punch down. And singling someone out, if he wanted to say a general comment about women in football, then, you know, as unfortunate as it is, he's entitled to his opinion on that. But when you start singling people out, I'm sorry, but that's just flat track bullying. And there's words I would love to use about Joey Barton for that. But I can't, because Dave would probably get rid of me rather quickly. But yeah,
against Joey Barton, mate, you might stand a chance.
Well, yeah, true enough. It's, I mean, this guy's got form for being a bully. We're talking about years ago when he stubbed a cigar out in a young player's eye at a Christmas do. Yeah. This guy is a prat of the highest order. And to be honest, yeah, all he's done is highlighted what a prat he is, what a bigot he is, and basically just showing how unemployable he is, either in the media world or as a football manager, who ultimately, football clubs now not only have the men's teams, the junior teams, but women's teams and girls' teams as well. There's not a club with an inch of moral fibre would take him now.
Yeah, it's interesting to hear you guys talk. There's a couple of things in this conversation, and you've really got to tread carefully in this modern day and age, with social expectation as it is. The point on women on men's football, make no mistake about it, that was a conscious decision by network chief execs. It was we need to reflect the women's game in the men's game, so let's go out and find somebody who can be on a punditry panel. That was a definite 100% intended decision by somebody, and then the others followed suit. So I don't know whether it was the Beeb first. I think it was who put a female on a men's panel in men's football. So suddenly Sky had to react, ITV, Channel 4 when they do games, etc. They all felt they had to follow suit. So that was a pressure from the modern day social environment we live in, that somebody made a decision, everybody felt they had to follow suit. So, you know, make no mistake about it. That was almost social pressure to do that. Which is great, because suddenly people who'd so used to seeing blokes on TV talking about football will suddenly see a professional female footballer, and maybe, just maybe, they'll start thinking about the women's game, which is on the rise. It's fantastic. And that's why you don't see a man. You're right, Ted. That's why you don't see a man normally on a punditry panel for a women's game, because they're growing the sport. So that's that. That's a completely separate issue to what happened with Joey Barton. Where Joey Barton, and you're right, sadly, he is entitled to his own opinion. Sadly, I use that term. Where he crossed the line for me yesterday was by singling out that Manchester City fan. He was basically saying women shouldn't be in football. That's what he was basically saying by singling out that individual in question. Yep. And quite rightly, she's got every right to be in the stadium. Quite rightly, she's got every right to be proud of following a team. Quite rightly, she's got every right to be... Well, I suppose technically she's not allowed to be shooting video inside the football stadium because there are ground regulations to stop you, but, you know, clubs don't stop fans from doing that. So quite rightly, she's got every right to do what she's doing. And for him to single out her was basically Barton going the next step that his mouth didn't, which was to say women shouldn't be in football. That's what he did wrong yesterday.
Yep, no, I completely agree. That's perfectly summed up. And I think there's not much more we can say on it, really, other than that.
We're delighted to welcome Joey Barton to the show next week.
There's a Joey from Bristol on the line.
I mean, let's face it.
It's good to speak to you.
let's face it, lads. I mean, his managerial career hasn't exactly been a huge success either, has it?
I think
what he did yesterday was he more or less, you know, curtailed any opportunity that he's got in this current day and age of getting a media job. And it's a pity because, you know, when he is, you know, on stage doing a talk in, for example, like I've done with him in the past, he's quite an intelligent bloke. And I just think that you've made your name now. You've been controversial in the past. We can all change. We can all, you know, we all deserve a second chance, if you like. But, you know, I just think he's put himself back to the back of the queue now, and he's never going to be accepted. There are certain networks which will entertain you. We saw that last night, and you know, that is it. You know, I don't know where he's punditry.
His punditry career on TV lasted Piers Morgan. That was it.
Yeah, that's it.
I really don't.
Has the Daily
really
Sport got a TV channel?
I mean, from I think from my point of view as well with Joey Barton, I think he just, like I say, he just does these things to be controversial, and that's it. And I don't think it'll be the last we hear from him on social media. I think he'll continue to stoke the fires. And yeah, we will see how it all progresses. But we go around in circles with this, Dave. I mean, you've worked on the continent, you know, with, and that's not incontinent, Dave.
Stop it. Right, we get this cushion out again.
You've worked on the continent. I mean, am I right in thinking it was a European idea with, you know, women in sport, women in football on TV? Because I remember when Gazzetta Italia used to be on.
The US have done it. Because they do have, their women's football was actually far in advance in terms of infrastructure than the men's, because, you know, it was considered quite well, and still is considered by some Neanderthals over in America, that, you know, it's a girly sport. So the US have done it for a while. I've seen some of the US women's national team members on punditry panels for men's football for some time.
Because I think that was part of the reason, you know, I mean, obviously from our perspective, it's different. In the UK, women's football has grown from strength to strength, and we have more female presenters on various programmes because of that. But I think it was the Italian networks who started using women as the as the main host on their programmes. But shall we say that the reason they were being picked wasn't the fact that they'd kicked a ball for the Italian women's football team.
Yes, that's right. Let's just say they.
Do you think that
they had other assets? Yeah,
they had other assets. Yeah. So do you think that's the reason? Do you think that's the reason that there was, you know, maybe the people are a little bit more, how can we put it, insulting towards having female presenters in this country, because these other women, you know, the women in Italy have come forward and people are just going, oh, well, they're just trying to do what they're doing in these other countries. Do you think that's potentially the reason that like Joey Barton has a pop?
No, I mean, I can't tell you the reason why Joey Barton has a pop, other than obviously he has his own opinions, and
he's not the first person to do it, mate.
No, he's not. This has been rumbling now, you know, for the past. I've seen it rear its head a couple of times in the last 3 or 4 months, from different people. But the honest reason why you're now seeing in the UK female footballers on men's football panels, if we can phrase it that way, is because there's social expectation. There's pressure on media execs to be politically correct, to appear to be conforming to what the expectation of what the present day norm is, and that is to include women. You know, there is that pressure that's sitting there, and make no mistake about it, that first decision was a politically correct driven decision to have a female face on a men's football panel. You can't hide that fact. That is true. Now, that's got nothing to do with how well the female footballer pundits are doing. You know, some of them are speaking very well indeed on football panels. I mean, it's, you know, like you say, it's either your thing or it isn't your thing, from a viewing perspective. But, you know, people like Joey Barton decides that women shouldn't be in the game, and he's got to get himself some column inches.
Okay, disgusting. We'll watch it. Yeah, we'll watch it with interest. Okay, we've got about 6 minutes till we come to the news headlines at the top of the hour. So,
let's look at
Paul Pogba. News coming out last night that he could face up to a 4-year ban after testing positive for testosterone. The counter analysis results also returned positive. Is that too long, or is it not enough, lads? Because, you know, ultimately taking something you know, to enhance performance is, you know, it's cheating. There's no other word for it. But with football, you don't hear much about this. You tend to hear a lot about it with, you know, say weightlifting in the Olympics, for example. Cycling, we've seen some big controversies in the Tour de France, people who compete in those.
Lance Armstrong, probably the biggest out of the lot.
Yeah, exactly. Great documentary that on Sky about him. But we don't often hear it with football, but this has dragged on a little bit. And Pogba, who was, you know, once regarded as one of the world's greatest talents in modern day football, seems to be he's fell off his pedestal and seems to be, you know, going further down the mountain. But what's your views on this? Because I think I think a 4-year ban for this. And I mean, again, we don't know the full ins and outs. Is it something he's, is it something that he's taken unknowingly? Is it something that he's, that he's taken, you know, knowing exactly what it, what he's doing? I mean, what's your views, lads, on this? Is a 4-year ban enough, or is it too much?
For me, I mean, if there you go, Dave. See, if it's proven that he's tried to buy performance enhancing drugs, then he wants a refund. Because he's been crap for about 4 years.
Classic.
Good to see the legal training kicking in here.
Thank you. My solicitor helped me with that one.
She also brought you coffee this morning, did she?
Absolutely, you're not even wrong. it's a strange one. I mean, for one, I'm being serious, though. Performance-enhancing drugs, Paul Pogba.
What does it actually do, though? What does testosterone do? I don't understand. I know. I mean, I thought it was for
Joey Barton going a bit mad on Twitter.
I thought it was just going to help him. You know, it says I'm reading here that testosterone can help with increased muscle and bone mass. Where I thought it helped with bone mass, but the other bone mass, if you get what my drift, you know what I mean, and the growth of body hair. I don't get what this has done to enhance his performance on the pitch.
Makes you look like a caveman.
He's just a more hairier midfielder. If that puts people off, then so be it. I don't know. I completely don't understand it. But if that's what he's taking to be a better footballer, then, and it's illegal, then, you know, you've broken the rules and that's it. So, unfortunately, 4 years is a bit rough. That's the end of his career.
Well, I think anybody who is found guilty of taking performance enhancing drugs, and we don't, I'm not clever enough to understand how each individual drug would enhance your performance and what it does to the body. But if that's what's proven, they should be kicked out of the game for a chunk of time. 4 years, God, that sounds long. You know, because you've got to come back with that stain attached to you anyway, and your reputation as somebody who has cheated. And that in itself would restrict where you could go and probably your earning potential, etc. 4 years. I mean, football playing careers are not that long. 4 years is huge. I mean, in cycling, it's only 2 years, isn't it? I've seen, you know, people done for a year, for 2 years. I haven't seen them done for 4 years. I could be well wide of the mark because this is not my field, but it seems excessive.
Yeah, if it's 4 years, maybe it makes him 34 at the end of it. Yeah, exactly. You're 34 at the end of it. There's no way you take Paul Pogba at the age of 34 after doping allegations. You know what I mean? It just doesn't happen. So, and if it is, it's a very, very low league club that, you know, probably wants the publicity of where the guys that signed Paul Pogba again. So, yeah, it's a career ender. So, you know. Whether he's done it knowingly or unknowingly, I still don't understand because his performances on the pitch haven't improved either. So he would want a refund for sure.
Yeah, well, it's an interesting one. With other sports, it's something which it certainly can enhance performance. But this seems to have dragged on for an eternity, and I just personally can't see how, you know, his career can start again after 4 years. I mean, we think Tonali has got a mountain to climb coming back in August. After a 10-month ban. But yeah, that is strange. We'll watch with interest as to what happens with Paul Pogba and maybe touch on that again in the future. Okay, here we are, 8 o'clock. Time for your news headlines.
Ah, bit of a genius, wasn't he? Him and Paul McCartney, both geniuses in their own right. What was the reason for playing that, Steve?
It's the anniversary of John Lennon's death today.
Oh, yes. Remember the news breaking. I am old enough. Right, so from Lennon to tired legs and sore feet, because Dean's joining us this morning. He reached out literally 10 minutes ago and he went, "Hey, fellas, can you give us a plug? I'm walking from Willington Cricket Club to Durham Cathedral tomorrow to raise money for Feeding Families." And Dean joins us now. Morning, mate.
Morning, how you doing?
I'm all right. Not the right time of year to be doing these walks, mate. It's blooming freezing out there.
I've just seen the forecast for tomorrow as well. I think it's heavy rain throughout the walk, which isn't great. No. But there you go.
Dear me.
Give us all the reasons why, mate. Why are you doing it?
Basically, my daughter came home about 3 weeks ago with some leaflets saying, "Dad, please, please help." Obviously, with my film stuff, she thought, you know, I could, you know, get in touch with the media and stuff. And we actually visited the local office, and it was pretty heartbreaking, if I'm honest, when you realise what some people are going through.
This is feeding families, isn't it?
Feeding families, yeah, sorry. And they offer, like, support and security to people across the northeast who are experiencing food poverty. And the scary statistic is they've already potentially going to help 11,316 households this Christmas, and that number is rising as we get closer to Christmas.
Wow.
And they've already, through this is stats from them, by the way, emergency meals donated in the past year, this is what scared me, 346,731, and that is terrifying. And that is just across the northeast. So it's scary, and I thought, what can we do? I'm in my 50s now. I'm not the fittest, I admit that. So I just said to a good friend of mine who happens to, this is where this even gets worse, lads. He's a sergeant major, so this is going to be fun tomorrow, isn't it? in the rain with a sergeant major and with an unfit 51-year-old.
Absolute no mercy there, mate.
And all he keeps saying is, we can have a couple of pints when we get to the end. I'm like, I'll be lucky if I'm even walking by the time we get to the end, let alone have a pint. But it's literally to do this, to raise funds for them, to raise awareness, because it is desperately needed, and I didn't realise. I mean, you know it's going on, we all know it's going on, but until you sort of step foot in these places and see what they're doing, and you look in these, you know, they're warehouses, and they're literally full of boxes full of food that are going to people that just need help, and it really is. And I just thought, I'm so passionate about this, I've got to do it. So I thought, what can I do in this short amount of time? So Willington Cricket Club's a big love of mine, and I'm going to walk there to Durham Cathedral, very iconic, and along the way, hopefully, pick up some friends and colleagues to help me along, and hopefully as well, obviously, raise loads of money for them.
Well done, mate. Yeah, we did a little bit with me and Dave did a little bit for feeding families when we did the curry night at Raval Restaurant earlier this year, and we managed to raise £1,000 for them. And for us, it was really important getting involved with them, because you know, big multi-purpose charities, you know, multinational charities have all the backing in the world, and you know, these local charities, especially at this time of year, really need our help. You know, and it's a travesty that we have to have things like food banks, the North East Food Bank, the Sunderland Food Bank, you know, and feeding families are doing a fantastic job, mate. So credit to you, mate, and you know, good luck with it, because you know, as I say, people like you make a huge difference.
I've noticed one.
Thank you very much.
I've noticed one four part in your plan. You're finishing at Durham Cathedral. That means when the legs are absolutely shot, you've then got to walk up the hill.
Yeah, I think that's why the sergeant major might be there, to be honest. He might be on piggyback duties by the time we get to Durham, which might be embarrassing. it's going to be, I mean, like I say, people keep going, oh, it's only 7 miles. I'm like, 7 miles for someone that does no fitness work apart from running around after the kids. You know, I'm a filmmaker, so I'm lazy. So I also eat the wrong foods. I eat loads of junk food. So to do it is going to be an achievement for us. And I called him in because I know that he'll help us along the way and get me. Because when it gets towards the end and I am absolutely shot, as you said, he'll be there just to say, come on, we can do it. And hopefully I've got a few members of my family and friends to wait for us at Durham Cathedral to get us over that finish line, as we say.
Yeah, and Google's telling me it's 2 hours, 39 minutes, mate, to do it. So,
Yeah. Well, that'll double that. It might be 2 hours, 39 minutes for a sergeant major, but it'll be probably near 4 hours for a 51-year-old fat bloke from Durham.
Brilliant. Love it. If people want to try and get involved, contribute in any way, have you got any sites up where people can, you know, make a few donations?
Yeah, so it's across all my social media. So it's Dean Midas Films, and Midas is M-I-D-A-S, Dean Midas Films, and I'm across all of the social networks everywhere. So you'll find it, and I've put my links everywhere this morning for people to donate. We've already had one donation, which is lovely. So we're up to £188 already, and the target's £500. So we're edging away at it.
Brilliant.
What kind of films do you make, Dean?
Horror films. So I make short horror films. So scary ones.
So are you taking the camera on the walk? Because that'll be a bit of a horror moment for you, won't it?
It will when I get to the North Road in Durham, I'm telling you that now. But yeah, it will be. We're getting someone to come along and just film bits of it. And obviously along the way, I will be asking people to help us and donate as we get along. So, but yeah, we'll be doing a little bit of video blog of it, and we'll put it out maybe tomorrow afternoon, just to let everyone know what we've done who maybe's missed it.
You're going to come on Monday morning? Tell us about it.
Yeah, I'll be okay to talk. Don't ask me to walk to your studio, because you'll have no chance.
Well, if you ever need a monster, mate, we can fly Rye over from Australia, mate. He doesn't need any makeup.
Yeah, they're low budget, so that'll do me nicely.
And he often wails like a banshee on this programme, so he'll be perfect.
Exactly,
mate.
Exactly. That's very true. It's very true. Got a good scream.
Well, give him a shot, right? Give him a scream.
The Barra! That'll get you up that hill tomorrow. Don't you worry about that. Watching Michael Carrick and the Barra get up tomorrow.
I'm literally going to save that and play it as I'm getting to North Road tomorrow.
Yeah, see? Yeah, it'll be like Rocky in your ears.
There you go.
Good luck with it, mate. It's a great... It's honestly... I was muted for a bit there. I was listening in. I just had a screaming baby in the background and I didn't want to ruin anything. But honestly, great achievement, great effort, and great that you've decided to do something as well. And it's incredible that, you know, how we get inspired these days. And obviously, you're seeing a warehouse full of, you know, crates of food. It changes you, doesn't it? And seeing how many people are suffering from poverty and homelessness and you know, you think at Christmas time when it's, you know, you've got family around, you've got full, you know, dinners, full tables worth of food, and that someone else is going hungry, it just doesn't cross your mind as much as it should. So good on you for making an effort. Good on you for doing something. And I was 12 years in the military, mate. I know exactly what a sergeant major's like. So yeah, good luck with that one. I wish you all the best up that hill, mate. And take care. And honestly, the only advice I'll give you is yes, sir, no, sir, three bags full, sir. That's all you need to say.
Yeah. I think I'm more scared of him than doing the walk, if I'm brutally honest. But there you go.
I would be too.
Yeah. Correct choice of word, by the way. Correct choice of word. Brutal. They can be. Yes. Brilliant, Dean. Thanks, mate. We'll talk to you on Monday and get the lowdown on how it went. Fantastic.
Thanks for having me on, lads. Cheers. Appreciate it. Thank you.
Cheers, man. Good luck.
Dean from Dean Midas Films, if you want to search him out on socials and make a donation. Fantastic stuff.
Horror films, man.
Horror films.
I don't think I've ever heard someone that makes them. I can't do horror. I know I've spoken about this many times on the radio. I can't do them.
No, I'd be honest.
I watched a great one last night, lads. It was called Murder at Goodison.
It was about this goalkeeper with really short time. Arms.
That was the most terrifying part.
Let's find out more.
There is one I'm looking forward to though, early next year. It's called The Third Round. It's coming out January-ish, I think it is. So yeah, The Third Round is going to be a big horror film for especially for a neutral. I'm looking forward to that one.
Excellent.
It's trying to be funny, but I'm not biting. Are you done
and dusted with your little rivalries here? Because it's time for the news headlines. Here we go.
Time for the news headlines.
Magpies and Proud. Mag News.
Well, here we go again, lads. The news headlines for Friday morning. And Newcastle suffered their fifth defeat of the season following a 3-0 loss against Everton at Goodison Park. United looked to be heading for a draw, but the fatigued visitors were undone by 3 goals in the final 11 minutes of the game after Dwight McNeil, Albert Doucouré and Biko all scored on the score sheet. Callum Wilson expects Anthony Gordon to become an England international, providing he can continue to impress at Newcastle United. Alongside Nick Pope and Kieran Trippier, the number 9 is one of 3 Toon players with a 3 Lions recognition to his name. 6 goals and 5 assists in 13 Premier League games have showcased a man reborn following his nightmare at Everton. Helping England under-21s win the Euros over the summer, where he was named player of the tournament, also stands him in good stead with England manager Gareth Southgate. And Newcastle United will make a short trip to Wearside in the third round of this season's FA Cup on Saturday, January the 6th, with a 12:45 kickoff now confirmed, and it's going to be live for the nation on ITV1. The away allocation of tickets and prices are still awaited. This is the first time we had Derby in the FA Cup since the quarter-final tie in 1956, and the first time ever that Newcastle United and the Magpies have met in a competitive match when not in the same division. That's the Newcastle United headlines on Friday morning.
Magpies and Proud. Black Cats News.
Good morning, Sunderland fans. No downbeat tones over this neck of the woods. The date and time has been set for our Emirates FA Cup third round tie against Newcastle United. The Black Cats host the Magpies at the Stadium of Light on Saturday, the 6th of January. Kickoff is at 12:45 p.m. in the first We're Tying derby since 2016. The fixture has also been selected by ITV for live broadcast and really is the pick of the third round fixtures given the fierce rivalry over the years. The club have stated on the SAFC website that ticketing information will be released in due course. Sunderland are reportedly interested in Benjamin Rolheiser as they prepare for clubs to make a move for Jack Clark during the January transfer window. Rolheiser currently plays for Estudiantes in Argentina, and he managed to score 12 goals in all competitions last season. He previously only scored twice across the entirety of his career before that campaign. The Times reports that Sunderland have made a move for Rolheiser, but he will cost around £6 million. However, you would imagine that he will have reservations while the Black Cats do not yet have a manager in place. Speaking of which, and finally, former England international turned pundit Carl Palmer has had his say on the potential appointment of Will Still, claiming it would be a great move for both parties. He said, another name that's been mentioned for the vacant manager's role at Sunderland is Will Still, the current manager of Reims, who are in fifth place in the race for Champions League football in France. Would he leave Reims to manage Sunderland? 110% if he was given the opportunity. This would be an exciting appointment. He's young, likes working with young players and developing them, which fits into Sunderland's criteria. His parents are English and he was born in Belgium. For such a young man, he's already experienced different roles in the game, from analyst to scout to assistant manager and now manager. So I guess we'll need to ask, will the Will Still story stay still, or will we retest Will's will and steal still as he seemingly fits the Sunderland bill? That's your headlines for Sunderland.
Smoggies and Proud. Borough News.
Good morning, Borough fans. The headlines out of Australia is that I just burnt my lip on a really hot cup of tea, and ooh, does it sting. I'm going to try and do my best to read these out, but I've got a real big stinging lip. But it's just like the injury list at Middlesbrough is starting to pile up down here in Australia as well. Middlesbrough will be without 10 first-team players as they invite second-place Ipswich Town to talk to... There it is, the lips getting away to take the side on Saturday. Forever coy on injuries. Michael Carrick said he was only keen to talk about those that are available rather than the ones that aren't. Michael was quick to say, however, it hasn't changed the Middlesbrough approach come January. Michael said if you have to be careful buying someone to replace anyone that's suffering from an injury, because at some point that player will return and then he would have brought someone into his spot. So you have to make it a great balancing act. Understandable there. And on that transfer front as well, a fresh update from the Daily Mail has revealed that Nottingham Forest have banished their captain Joe Worrell from first team training and confirmed that he will be allowed to leave the club in January, along with fellow centre-back Scott McKenna. Both have been linked to Middlesbrough in the previous months, with Joe Worrell being a name that is on everyone's hit list come January. So, banished there for a Nottingham Forest captain, can you believe it? And Michael Carrick has sent his best wishes over to Mogga, admitting it was sad to see the Middlesbrough legend lose his job at Sunderland this week. Carrick said, in the position I'm in, it's never nice to see a fellow manager or head coach lose their job for whatever reason. I know Tony and I've spoken to him over a period of time from being here. We've played against him a few times and he's a good man. And Middlesbrough will be buoyed by their performance against a strong Leeds squad last week, losing to a penalty that never should have been, and hosting the second place team. There won't be much motivation needed for those who do take the pitch on Saturday. Come on, the Borough!
Ted, Rye and Steve, the North East Footy Breakfast.
Right across the North East, the Red, the Cat and the Tin.
Okay, 20 past 8. Crazy. Friday morning, we've made it to the end of the week, and we've got a couple of topics to get through. But Ange Postecoglou,
before we go on to Ange, we've got Dan on. We've got our guest on. Steve, pull those horses back.
Okay.
Okay.
Oh, now I feel sorry for him.
I do.
It's his show. You can't control him. All right, it's his need show. A hug. Go on, Steve.
Thanks, Ray. Thanks.
Do you want me to do an intro? Mate.
Yes.
You do it, mate.
Right.
I forgot about your guest.
You've sorted Dan out. You've got to do the intro.
Our next guest, it's one of these really rare opportunities, lads, because it's the son of one of my oldest friends, and when you're bringing a guest on the show who's a fully grown-ass man and an adult now, and obviously remember him being born as well, Dan is a young up-and-coming referee within the Sunderland area. He's a mad keen Sunderland fan as well. Obviously, we want to talk to him about the whole refereeing thing. Like, why do you get into it? He's a good lad. Dan, good morning. How are you, mate?
Good morning. Yeah, I'm all right. How are you?
I'm very good, mate.
More power to your elbow for being an up-and-coming referee, mate, than being a Sunderland fan, I've got to say.
I did warn you in advance, Dave. Dave would love you straight away for being a referee. I guess the first question, Dan, is why? a young lad.
That is the first question people always ask me. Why?
Are you mad?
I just want to do it.
Yeah. Especially a young lad. Come on, shed some light on it. What made you take an interest in refereeing first?
When I used to play football for Hetton Juniors, there was just one night at training that said, oh, we're going to put you through the reffing badges for anyone who wants to do it. So I think it was about four or five of us went down. And it was just to earn a bit of money, to be fair, just because I knew I liked football. Yeah. I knew the basic rules of it. So I thought, oh, how hard can it be? I did realise quite quickly that it's a lot harder than I thought it would be.
Fair comment.
And then I started going to referees association meetings where like a lot of referees around like the Northeast could get together and just like discuss all things refereeing, and I kind of got a little bit hooked. And when you get guest speakers like Kevin Friend and Michael Oliver coming in and they're kind of telling you about their career, it's like, oh, this is quite cool, you know? And I've just kind of kept going from there, I guess.
Love it. Yeah, exactly the same path that I followed, that I did pick up refereeing late. I played a lot longer. And it is, the guys won't understand it, and they'll probably, you know, probably turn around and say, you sad pair of buggers, you. But when you do sit in these RA meetings and you do have Premier League refs talking to you, and you are listening to the stories you know, the tales of their career path, you think, that could be me. And all you've got to do is be a half-decent referee and be willing to learn, and it can be you. I'm living proof, you know. It can be this bloke from Teesside who refereed a game in front of 110,000 people in a stadium, because that's what happened to me. It does happen.
Yeah. Yeah, 100%. It's nice to know that there's more of a path there. And you know, we go to these meetings all the time and they keep saying that the opportunities in refereeing are like the best that they've ever been. And, you know, like you do see it when you get in the go at certain places and do different things.
So what level are you at, and what sort of age group do you referee, Dan?
So I only referee adult football now, really. I'm a level four, which means I referee Northern League.
Yeah.
And I can be assistant referee in Northern Premier League as well.
Is that right? You ran the line for a South Shields game. Was that the televised one?
I don't think it was the televised one. But yeah, that was the start of last season, I think.
Obviously, I've known your mum a few years now, and she was proud as punch. Obviously, if I want to keep a touch of your career, it's refer to your mum first, because she's always going on about it. Bless her. I mean, without giving too much away, obviously you're a young man, you're still in your teens. What is the biggest pressure do you find for a young and upcoming referee like yourself?
Ooh, I think, especially when I got a level four, I found that when I'm arriving with two assistant referees, the hardest thing is showing up and people not looking at you as the referee. Because you've got potentially two older lads stood next to you. And they're like, oh, here's the team sheets. I'm like, nah, pass them this way. So you're almost starting on the back foot a little bit, and you almost have to work a little bit harder at the very start of a game to say that, yeah, I'm here for a reason, and I can do the job. So you just have to get past that. But
how old are you, Dan?
Yeah, see, that's I'm 20 now.
20? Wow.
Yeah, 21 in January.
I still had you in your teenagers. Sorry, mate.
No, but that, you're dead right. I mean, that is, you know, that is a major hurdle, being so young. And if you are surrounded by a couple of older guys, is that credibility factor. And you take that straight onto the pitch, because the players will look at you beforehand. Oh, you know, how long's he been doing it? He's wet behind the ears. He hasn't got experience. All that. You know, I mean, you've done it long enough now. Even in your tender years, you've been refereeing long enough to realise that that carries onto the pitch. So it's just vitally important you go out there full of confidence and you show them that you can manage the game. You can manage 22 players. You know, you do have that self-belief, because I tell you what, fellas, outside of me and Dan talking here, if you go out there being a bit of a timid creature and not wanting to talk, they'll destroy you. They really will. They'll look for any weakness they can to leverage against you. So, no, but brilliant. It's great to hear, Dan. Great to hear.
A bit like us with you, Dave, yeah?
Yeah, it is. Yeah, absolutely.
Morning, Dan. It's Ryan here from Australia, mate. I'm going to have to start hitting you with the tough questions now. I'm sorry, mate. I apologise. I'm closer to you in age.
It's all right. I've briefed them.
Did you say Ted's held you as a baby? Well, forget that. Don't worry about it. When you become a referee, how do you choose the perfect whistle?
Perfect whistle.
Fox. I bet he's got a Fox 40.
Perfect whistle.
I bet he's got a Fox 40.
Yeah, it's a Fox 40. Yeah.
Yes!
Yay! Great, so you know your whistle.
I don't know what that is.
It's good to see. A great tool.
No, serious question. We're talking yesterday on the show about young referees in lower leagues now starting to wear body cams. They've spoken about how the FA were trialing wearing body cams. I just wanted to ask if you've ever experienced wearing a body cam, if as a referee, if it makes you feel at all safer in the lower leagues or anything like that when there's a bit of crowd trouble, and if you're for it.
I think I've never experienced wearing one. I don't know, obviously, how successful the trial's been, but
it was trialed in North Riding, just over the border, Dan. So, I mean, you're a Durham ref, I'm assuming, being in County Durham.
Yeah,
yeah.
North Riding.
And North Riding trialed it through Ross Joyce, who's a Football League referee. He was their RTO until he moved to Wembley, to head office a few weeks ago. And apparently it's been a massive success, and the guys and girls were wearing the body cams. Reduced a descent.
Yeah, it says here they've trialled it in now 500 games, and they've been so impressed. There's been not one incident in the 500 games that a referee's worn a body cam. So they're loving the trials, and they're experiencing. They're hoping to spread it out to other referees before bringing it into the higher leagues, hopefully to protect referees and to get better on pitch communication back to those sitting on the sideline. So. I think it's for us. We were talking about it yesterday, and we were all for it, especially in the, you know, the grassroots football and stuff like that. When you get crowds that are getting a bit rowdy, you get the dad that doesn't like that you just red carded his son or whatever it may be. I guess obviously you haven't experienced wearing it, but would you be for it? Would you know if you were approached to wear a body cam in a game, would you be for it, or is it something you probably could do without?
I think for me personally, it's probably something I wouldn't do just because of the level I'm at now. Because the higher you go up, the more protection you get. But Sunday League football, for example, it's a very, very lonely place. When you haven't got assistance and you're there on your own in the middle of a park. So I can 100% see the benefit of that. And to be fair, if I was still refereeing Sunday League football, I may think about it. Because it's just that added layer of sort of
protection.
Prevention.
Yeah.
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 Yep. That's what you want. That's
I think just to bring it into context where Dan is right now, he's level 4. It probably means he's in the top 20% of referees in the country. So he's climbing. He's climbing. You know, if he jumps onto level 3, you know, I'm assuming it's still the same. You'd be refereeing in the Northern Prem, and you'd be on the line in the National League.
That's right.
Yeah, so that would move him into the top 7% of in the country. So he's climbing the ladder.
What's your ambition then?
I mean, you know, I don't think I'd be trying to push like I am and training and stuff if I didn't want to get to the top. I think that's where everyone wants to be. But obviously, I'm just going to take it as far as it goes. And at the minute, I still think I've got the potential to keep going. But then if it ever gets to a point where I'm like, oh, this is my level, then I'd probably still keep refereeing. But because you get to go to great places. I mean, next week I'm down at St George's Park for an England international. So it's like, it's stuff like that that kind of keep you going.
Brilliant.
Very nice, mate. Very nice. Obviously,
I'll just remember that we had you on the Northeast Brekkie show. I was right. The nicest one, and I'm a Middlesbrough fan. game, and also
he knows where he's spreads, but admit, don't you worry.
You show a red straight away because I know he's a bit lippy, that old Dan Neil. So I know you're a Sunderland fan. You put that to one side. All right, you look after the borough, and Ryan look after you, mate. That's no more needs to be said. No more needs to be said.
Ignore him. I can't let you go, Dan, without asking one last question. Obviously, I know you're a big Sunderland fan anyway, and you were shocked about the Tony Mowbray sacking as well. Who do you fancy for the new manager?
I quite fancy Will still, to be fair, from what I've read about him and seen online. I think he's quite young.
Is that just because you like listening to me doing the tongue twisters?
I did hear that one. It's quite impressive, actually.
Oh, but thank you very much, mate. Thank you very much. No, I think he's there is a bit of a fan excitement growing about him. He's obviously young and up and coming, and that's the route the club want to go in. So, I suppose it's we'll wait and see anyway. But I know you've got college, Dan, so we'll not keep you too much longer, mate. Thank you very, very much for coming on. I think we'll have you on again, and we'll maybe just have our new referee and expert, being as you're more in touch with the modern game.
Ooh. and Dan, if it's ever possible to come along and see you in action, I'd love to see how you're refereeing, mate. It'd be good.
Yeah, no problem.
Yeah, fantastic. We'll sort that
out
with Ted.
Fantastic. Thanks for coming on, mate.
Cheers, mate.
Cheers,
thank you.
Cheers,
Dan. Have a great day, mate.
Cheers.
Cheers,
nice lad. Sensible lad.
He's a great lad. Yeah. And that's how I get referees in my pocket. Yeah. No. Good. You know, you don't hear many stories of young referees that are coming and have ambitions to go to the top.
No. Well, he's doing well. He's doing well. If he's level 4 at 20, he's doing very, very well.
Yeah,
he's fair play, and there's good support network as well. I mean, I've been lucky enough to go along to a Sunderland RA event, behind enemy lines, I guess, with the referees. But it was actually a talk that Jack Ross gave when he was I dressed as Arsene Wenger because he never saw anything either. I went along to a do where Jack Ross actually talked along, and the Sunderland RA network, the way they support, the way they sort of create this positive culture around refereeing is really something. And the guy who's been running that for a long time, Colin Burnickle, deserves a lot of credit because there's a lot of work goes into running something like that. That's a fair play.
Cool. Yeah, and good on him. Wish him all the best.
We're just up to 8:30, so keeping on track, Dave, we need some sports headlines.
Thanks, Dave.
Ted, Rye and Steve, the North East Footy Breakfast. Right across the North East, the
red, the cat and the tin. Okay, Ange Postecoglou, who I was going to talk about before I forgot that Dan was coming on, said he's not interested in playing pretty football, lads. He's only interested in results. It's an interesting one, that, because it's a bone of contention with some supporters, isn't it? I've seen managers lose their jobs at Newcastle for playing the wrong style of football. West Ham, I guess, as well, have got the West Ham way. I think that irks with some fans, but a lot of people will say there's a particular way of playing football. But if you told me, that Sam Allardyce was coming back to Newcastle, I wouldn't thank you, because his particular brand of football, for me, isn't something I would like to watch as a Newcastle fan. But if you told me Kevin Keegan was going to make a return and play the entertainer style of football, that's what I would like to see. So it was an interesting one for him to bring up last night at his press conference after the game. And I mean, of course, West Ham turned a reverse into a win for themselves last night. Great result for the Hammers. And Ange Postecoglou, his bubble is starting to burst, I think. It's a battle of strength between him and Eddie Howe at the weekend, of course. He'd be hoping to get back on track with that. But just looking at what he said, I mean, what's your thoughts on that one, Ray? He's got, he's obviously going to be a bit down. He's lost the London Derby. The results aren't going for him as they were at the start of the season. He's going to get a little bit of criticism. But is he right to say that? Because obviously certain fans are saying that they don't like the style of football. It's something we touched on earlier this week. it's another defeat for him. And, you know, he's come out and said that. What's your thoughts? Is that going to get people on side, or is it going to get people against him?
Well, I think obviously, you know, the only thing that's going to get on side with Tottenham fans is results, isn't it? You know, Tottenham have such big ambitions as a club to be, you know, top four. And they want it, that's where they want to be, and they want any manager to get them there. Now, whether it's, you know, the way they play, as long as, you know, we saw him get, what was it, three back-to-back managers of the month, and now it seemed to have unraveled. But I think what's gone hand in hand with that is actually the injuries, much like over at Newcastle. Tottenham, have got about 10 or 11 players out with current injuries as well, and they're all first team players. You know, we're talking James Maddison, who's been incredible for them. You know, even Perisic, you know, who did his ACL, Eric Dier as well, Ryan Sessegnon. You know, the list goes on of actual important people. Bentancur as well, which I watched in the game against Aston Villa. He went down as well with an ankle foot injury, and he was incredible. So I think the way he's playing is always, now I've followed Ange for a long time. He's obviously an Australian coach. He's in a, you know, he was a coach of the Australian team for a bit there as well. And one thing you can always bet your bottom dollar on is that football is going to be played the Ange way. Now, the Ange way is always attack, attack, attack. It is always, you know, he doesn't worry about defending. He said the way you win goals is by outscoring the opposition. That's as simple as that. That's his method, and that's the way he's always been. Now, rightly or wrongly, sometimes it pulls it off. If you have got good strikers, you've got a good team like Tottenham, you know, did when they were all fit. You know, they lost Kane, but they got Son and James Maddison in, and they were scoring goals. And that was, you know, he got three managers of the month back to back. But then when you lose those players that start putting them in the back of the net, then you just sort of get found out defensively. And it's kind of like the Borough, funny enough, because we seemingly be the same. You know, we've got an attitude from Michael Carrick that we attack, attack, attack. We don't really worry about defensive, you know, nature, because it's, you know, we just try and outscore the other team. Now, when you stop scoring or you lose that player to injury, well, then your defensive capabilities come into play, because they're the ones that are going to get you over for 1-0 or 1-0. So, and unfortunately, Ange is now being found out. And whether, you know, when there's always, I've always said it, when there's a new manager on the scene, it does take a while for other managers to learn their tactics, learn the way, the style they play. And that's, you know, sometimes that's that when you see that new manager go in for what any club after a sacking or, you know, a change of guard, whatever it may be. There's always this sort of level of, you know, difference, because there's a bit of motivation there. Plus, there's, you know, the other managers and the other teams don't really have, you know, the book on how to, you know, coach against an Ange Postecoglou team. But now they do. Now they do. And we saw that last night with West Ham. They knew if they held on that they might be able to find a way through their defensive, you know, misdirection. So, yeah, look, I think he's never going to change. If you're asking me, is Ange Postecoglou ever going to change? No, he's never has, never will. If you look at Celtic, if you have a look at all his posts, he got sacked, or was either he got a new job, or he decided that that, you know, the chairman or whatever didn't want him to play the style of football he wanted to play, so he left. And if you're asking me, are Tottenham sort of falling away? I think they're having a bit of a blip, but I think they've also got to be kind to themselves at the moment, because Ange is working with a makeshift squad, much like Newcastle are, sort of thing. So it's interesting. I hope he has success. We've always wanted to see a good Aussie coach in the Premier League, and one that's can be successful. And I think, you know, Ange is our best chance of that. And I love the way he plays. I love the teams he puts out and the exciting football that he makes. So I hope he gets the chance to stick around. But he's never, ever going to change the way he plays football or his methodology around football, that is.
Ted?
Yeah, I'm glad you referenced Sam Allardyce, to be honest. It's an interesting one. Can you remember when Allardyce was West Ham manager and he was appointed when they were down in the Championship? They'd just been relegated to the Championship. And one of the questions from the media was, Sam, there's some sort of unrest among the supporters because you don't play the West Ham way. And his reply, which was epic, was, well, the West Ham way got them relegated, didn't it? Now, I get where he's going with that, and I love Big Sam. Our club wouldn't be in the mess it's in if he hadn't taken the England job. We were building something pretty special at Sunderland, and to be honest, the football I watched when he was there as Sunderland manager actually was quite exciting. I don't know whether it was just a byproduct of the desperation of trying to avoid relegation or what, but he brought a team mentality together, which, while it isn't the most technically beautiful football you'll ever watch, it was dynamic counter-attacking football with some blood and guts tackling, which, you know, North East football fans absolutely love to see that anyway. So for me, look, it's all about grinding out results. And, if somebody offered me, right, Sunderland are going to have boring 1-0 wins for the rest of the season and they're going to go up automatically, would I take it? Of course I would. Absolutely, of course I would. I want success. If it happens to be pretty football, then that's a bonus. But as long as it's, you know, the game played within the right spirit, within the laws of the game, hey, results are what matter. And that's what hires and fires managers, results.
Yeah, true, true. Dave, thoughts? I mean, would you prefer to see an attractive footballing team fall short and, you know, not win the Premier League? Or would you prefer to see, you know, a team that, you know, doesn't play attractive football but win the Premier League? It's you know, that's the question, really, I guess.
Can you hear me? Is it working? That's the big question, because I'm not really around using the gizmo.
Yeah. Oh, look at this. Look at this.
Well, no.
And just to prove just to prove it.
Oh,
there you go. No. Toilet flushing. There you go. I'm definitely not in the studio. No, I'm just messing about and walking around the building listening to you. Breakfast.
We're talking assistant managers, not those number twos, mate.
By the way, beautiful sight. I'm looking out the window in the corridor where the radio station is, and the sun is rising over Rosebery Topping in the North York Moors. Fantastic.
Nice.
Look, I remember Aitor Karanka and his era at the Borough, and we were playing terrible football, but we were getting results. And it's a real tough one, isn't it? Because there is that balance. You want your team to be successful. And are we being too greedy as football fans? Basically, then expecting to be entertained fully during that success as well. Now, only the best clubs, the best managers with the best players and the best tools available can do that. So if I had to choose between one or the other, I would rather have a successful football club than an unsuccessful football club, but they're playing pretty football. So that's where I'd go if I could only choose one. But obviously we all want, like, I suppose it's a bit like, apart from last night, a bit like Newcastle at the moment, playing exciting football. They're getting the results to be at the higher end of the Premier League. So that is the ultimate. Just going back to Ange and people sussing him out, I don't buy it, you know, because there are only 20 clubs in the Premier League. And I think everybody knows how everybody plays. Clubs have scouts. Managers go and watch games. Every game's televised. It's not as if you don't know how a team lines up. It's not as if you don't know what to expect from players, how they play. Yes, individual tactics for a particular game may change, but you're at the highest end of the trade. If you can't cope as a manager, as a set of players, with a team coming to your place or you going somewhere, you know, somewhere else, and there's a slight change tactically and you can't deal with that, you shouldn't be at the highest level of the game. So I don't buy into this. People have sussed Ange. People have sussed Michael Carrick. People have sussed. I think you can be sussed very quickly. It's just how you cope with it. And I think it's just down to, you know, it's down to a bad run of form. It's down to being too complacent. I think it's down to human error more than anything else.
Okay, we've got about 10 minutes left, so I just want to get in Steve Wraith's Christmas cracker, the Christmas joke of the day.
here we go,
lads. What happened to Mark Zuckerberg? Yeah, he won't have the button. He's not that prepared. What happened to Mark Zuckerberg?
I haven't been given a button.
Stop talking over his joke.
Constantly interrupted on this show. What happened to Mark Zuckerberg's novelty jumper when he had a cage fight with Elon Musk? He was left with nothing but threads. Okay. One of the better ones this week, lads. It was one of the better ones this week.
And I'm Radio Dad.
Yes, these are apparently the top 10 funniest new Christmas cracker jokes for 2023. Mate.
It's a cracker.
I like the apparently.
Who picked the
apparently,
top
10? As I've gone through the list this week, lads, I'm starting to doubt why on earth these are even in Christmas crackers. I certainly hope they're not in my Christmas crackers. There'll be no laughter in the Wraith household, that's for certain.
Do we need something like this at this moment in time? We'll get there.
Oh, that's great.
It's the Steve Wraith Christmas cracker.
I like it. Yeah, I like it. It's got potential.
Your top 10.
I love it.
So, tomorrow, early kickoff, live on Sky Sports. Ted, Sunderland versus West Brom. So take us there and give us your views and your predictions, man.
Yeah, it's a strange one, isn't it? It's the whole managerless thing again, and whether the players turn up and maybe give a performance, you know, out of a bit of a respect for Tony Mowbray, or whether it's kind of like, you know, whether it's a damn squib. It's a 50-50 one, this one, and I've got a very uneasy feeling about the next two games, if I'm really brutally honest with you. West Brom going to it having lost their last game, though, but they have got three wins out of the last five as well, so they're not in horrendous form. Whereas Sunderland, obviously, no win in the last three. To all intents and purposes, we could, if we're not careful, lose touch with this whole playoff thing very, very quickly. Having said that, with 3 points of it, I think there'll be a good crowd there behind. It's all going to hinge on the opening of the game. I think within the first 20 minutes, if Sunderland get a goal, I think the crowd will get, you know, behind them and push them on. And we're more than capable with the staff we've got of beating West Brom. That's absolutely a fact. However, if there's nothing on show within the first 20 minutes, the fans will get restless. They're already, you know, 50-50, if not more so, in favour of Tony Mowbray. So I think the natives could get a bit restless if they don't see anything that they like within the first opening few moments of that game. So, yeah, selection-wise, I don't see any sort of massive changes. I don't think anybody, there'll be no shock droppings or anything like that. The only thing, I think Job may come back in after he was rested in the last game. Other than that, it'll be much as you were. It'll be interesting to see who they picked to play up front. Mowbray had said that Hemia needed more game time and then didn't play him for the last two games, which was a bit of a strange one. So, yeah, whether there might be a little change of shape. I would love to, you know, I'm a purist. I would love to see us actually go out and play 4-4-2 and actually stick two strikers up the top and give them something different to worry about, because, like I've said many, many times, and when Mowbray was in charge as well, we were just too predictable. So I'd like to see them mix things up a little bit. Having said that, it's going to be a tough one. Look, at best, I think if we come out of this with a draw, I think we'll be happy with that. Now, that's what I'm going for. I'd mark it down as a ones each draw, and then we just put everything into the Leeds game, the one that's coming after that.
Yeah, I don't see you winning this.
Go on then, Wright. Give us your views on this.
They're not. Mackems aren't beating West Brom. The players that have tweeted out this week about Mogga leaving, and I refer especially to Luko9, which is Ted's favourite player, and he said that this is a photo that epitomised the gaffer. He treated us all like family and brought me and the lads and our club some unforgettable moments. I'll never forget you, gaffer. Right? So I just feel...
Well, if he hadn't defended like a schoolboy, he might still have a job.
If I just feel like there's some players in that club that will be absolutely still... just a bit lost without Mogga in there, and I don't think they're going to beat West Brom. I think Carlos Corberan will have West Brom up for it. It'll be at the Stadium of Light, early kickoff, and West Brom will win it. Just because, you know, the Sunderland have lost a bit of direction this week until they find that new manager.
Okay, so what's your prediction then, Ray?
I'm going for a defeat. I'm going to go for 3-0 to West Brom.
Ooh, ouch. Yeah, I'm going to go a little bit more optimistic for the Mackems. You know, there's no new manager. Mowbray's gone. Some of those people in the dressing room will be happy about that. Let's see what teams, you know, is picked. I'm going to go for a draw, mate. I'm going to go for a 1-1 draw. That's my feeling. Dave?
I'm going to go exactly the same, mate. 1-1 draw.
1-1 draw. Okay,
and Daz is here.
Yeah, good morning.
Radio
good morning,
Chase.
Good morning, Daz.
Good morning, mate.
Morning, Daz. Give us your prediction.
Oh, I got a pointed finger in my direction when I said that. Oh. He's threatening me. No bacon
hang
buddy.
Hang on, did he bring a bacon buddy?
No bacon buddy.
Did he bring
buddy.
A bacon buddy?
No bacon
no
buddy.
Bacon. Oh, left no. Out. The bet.
I'm going for a defeat for Sunderland. I'm sorry. I'm going for 1-0.
Thank you, Daz.
Thank you. Okay.
Some sanity.
Borough versus Ipswich, Rye. Come to you first. This is a humdinger, isn't it? This is a must win or bust for Borough, I think. This is against one of the promotion contenders. If Ipswich win this and get themselves on to 48 points, they are going to be wait for it.
They will not win.
21 points clear of Middlesbrough.
No. They will not win.
It is a massive game. It is a massive game. And obviously Middlesbrough are still struggling with those injuries crisis. Carrick obviously not confirming yesterday. In fact, I had a bit of a joke with Craig Johns after the fact because he was in the interview room and we're talking after the fact. And Michael Carrick just will not give anything away when it comes to injuries. He's so coy on it. He'd rather talk about the players he's going to put it on that pitch. And I do like that attitude. But we are, you know, without a doubt, still need to realise we're missing 10 first-team players as we go and take on the team in second. Ipswich without Sam Morsey and Massa Luongo, though, two of their instrumental midfielders in that role. So that's going to be interesting as well. It's a massive game. And we're at home at the Riverside, which, you know, Middlesbrough just seem to perform over and over again this season at the Riverside. Away days, I'd be a little bit more scared. But a packed Riverside Stadium against Ipswich, you'd boy at your bottom dollar that this team's going to do put in a good shift against them. The defensive capabilities, who fits in a right back, you know, all that sort of stuff is going to be interesting for me. Does Johnny Howson go in that right back role? If he does, who sits in that midfield? Does Matt Crooks drop far in and back? Does Sammy Silvera then come on? It's, you know, the team selection is going to be a massive one. Yeah. We might even see a surprise return from a couple of injuries that he just didn't want to talk about just to keep his cards close to his chest. He is a good friend of McKenna's as well. McKenna, the coach of Ipswich Town. They both were raised as coaches in the Man United era. So him and Carrick and McKenna are very, very close friends. They've shared a lot of, you know, conversations and discussion topics. They did their badges and stuff like that together. So there's a lot of respect for each other there as well. I'm going for a Borough win, though. I think we're going to just be able to do it at home against Ipswich. I just find, you know, the way we played against Leeds, you know, we're going to just be able to put any team on the ropes there. And we're just going to hope that Clarkey, and if it is, you know, Clarkey and Vandenberg, that they hold out a rampant Ipswich team. I'm going for a 2-0 victory to the Borough.
Ooh. 2-0 victory. Okay, Ted, your views on this one?
0-0.
That was a rather dismissive, Daz-like short answer, wasn't it?
It was,
Steve's
yes.
been trying to set us up with one for ages, so I had the courtesy to nod one in for him.
He's doing a Daz. I'm going to go for a 1-0 win to Ipswich. I think it'll be a tight game, but I think a 1-0 win to Ipswich on this occasion. Dave?
I just think, hewn out of Teesside steel, the grit and determination of the industrial landscape of our legacy. On that field, we're going to draw 1-1.
So that big build-up. Okay. Daz?
I think we'll have enough for them. I don't know. I know we're a bit Jekyll and Hyde at the moment. In terms of what comes out. But I'm going for a 1-0. I'm going to be positive. I think our makeshift defence will hold firm. And I think we'll do them 1-0.
Okay. Yes, boys. Last but by no means least, Newcastle face a trip to Spurs in the Premier League. Is it going to be a case of out of the frying pan and into the fire? Both teams losing last night. Pressure on Postecoglou from his supporters. No pressure on Eddie Howe. Will there be any players back? Newcastle, it's a happy hunting ground for the new stadium. White Hart Lane wasn't as happy. The way both teams are playing, I'm going to go for a 2-2 draw, lads. I think there'll be goals. I think Newcastle may have a player back, not sure who, but they will have either Wilson or Botman back, or maybe both, which will be a boost on the bench. But I'm going to go for a 2-2 draw. I don't think Kieran Trippier, in particular, can have as bad a night as he had last night. And I think, in front of the Sky cameras, Newcastle will manage to get a point, which will be seen as a good result.
Yeah, I agree with that, to be honest, Steve. I'm going to go with the ones each, though. Slightly less exciting in terms of the scoring. But I do expect Trippier doesn't have two bad games in a row. So I think he'll have a good performance. Wouldn't be at all surprised to see him bang one in the top corner from a free kick.
Yeah, it's coming, I think. Rye?
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm going for a Tottenham win in this one in a high-scoring affair. I'm going for 4-2 for Tottenham. Tottenham haven't not scored in the Premier League this season. There's always been a goal. There was one game, I think, against Wolves off the top of my memory where they didn't score, but every other game there's been one goal or more for Tottenham. Newcastle obviously still now learning their ropes with coming off, you know, a bad defeat to Everton. We saw that, you know, obviously, you know, Dubravka's going to have to settle into that role and stuff like that. And I think Tottenham are going to be looking pretty strong at home. Ange will have them up firing, and I'm pretty confident they're going to have a few back for their game as well. So, yeah, I'm going for a 4-2 victory to Tottenham in what's going to be a pretty entertaining game with two very, very good managers, attacking managers as well. So it's one to watch this weekend for me. And yeah, Tottenham 4-2.
Dave?
I'd just like Ladbrokes to get on the phone and tell me what odds I can get for 3-1-1 draws across the North East this week. Because that's what I fancy. I think it's going to be three draws. I'll be a million miles wide of the mark. You can all take the mick out of me on Monday, but I'm going for another 1-1.
Well, we will anyway.
that's but by no means least.
Love fact. It. Fact.
I think it's going to be a high-scoring game as well. I'm going for 3-3. I think it's going to be a thriller.
Oof.
Oh.
Wow. It's
going to
be a thriller.
Yeah. Speaking of Monday, boys.
Born in Manila, but it's going to be a thriller.
You've heard the predictions, speaking guys. Speaking of Monday.
Yeah, Monday.
On Monday, I think I'm going to be taking the show on Monday. I'm going to be actually broadcasting from a mystery location, gentlemen.
Using our new gizmo. Yeah. Are you using our new gizmo?
Okay.
No, Mrs. Ted has taken me away for my birthday. It's also my birthday on Monday, you see.
Right.
She's taken me away for the weekend, so I'll be waking up in a mystery location to do the show. I've just been told to bring the laptop, bring the microphone. It's either a hotel or a hitman. I don't know. I should be all right, though.
Let me go.
Ow, mister. Let me go. I've got a show to do. Well,
he's back. He's back.
Considering it is your birthday.
When did I turn into one of the Stott brothers? Like?
Let me know, Ted, because it is your birthday. I'm happy to take the highlights for you, you know, and give you the day off so you can just sit there.
No, that's fine. It's all about me on Monday. It's my birthday. I can do what I want.
Right, fair enough.
All right, then. Fellas, we're done and
dusted. We have reached the end.
We have.
Well done, lads. Yes.
I want to squeeze at least 1 minute of music in, so before the news.
Woo!
Have a great weekend. Up the Borough, of course, we're going to be high-flying. We're going to do Ipswich 6-0 at the Riverside. 1-1.
Big day.
Yeah, indeed.
From the pub to the Riverside.
And Rye's going to be he doesn't know yet, but Rye's going to be on match day live from the six medals, live before the Borough game. He doesn't know yet, but he's going to be
Excellent. Nice one, Rye.
Yep. All right, fellas.
Yep, thank you.
Have a great weekend.
Have a good weekend, boys.
Catch you.
Have a good weekend.
Catch
you soon. Up the Borough.
From Yarm to Yearbeach, Herrington to Horsley Hill, Swalwell to Silverlink, the North East Footy Breakfast. With Rye, Steve and Ted.
Right across the North East, the red.